I want to talk basically. I don't want to talk. I'm probably going to end up teaching. And I'll be doing the same this evening. It seems that I'll be stepping into that gift of teaching tonight. I just want to talk on one verse basically this morning. I want to talk on Mark chapter 10, verse 45. Just one verse. Mark 10, verse 45. And it says this. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. You know, people who refuse to get involved in community, in the problems of the community, what's going on, are like two shipwrecked men who are in a lifeboat. From their end of the boat, the pair watched as those at the other end of the boat bailed frantically to keep the boat afloat. And the one turned to the other and said, "Thank heaven the hole is not at our end of the boat." Now, unfortunately, that seems to be very typical of a lot of people in our society. Because the trouble with much of society is that they don't realize that the boat is going to go down no matter where the hole is. Friends, you and I have got to share the responsibility of our church. Each of us has got a responsibility, and part of that responsibility is to save the unity of the church. Let me personalize it if I can. If I'm talking about myself, this is what I would expect of myself. I will save the unity of our church by acting in love towards the other members. I will save the unity of our church by refusing to gossip. I will save the unity of the church by following the leaders. You see, as a church, our mission, our responsibility is to spread the good news of Jesus. Full stop. Yeah. That's our mission. Spread the good news of Jesus. We are here to seek and save the lost, and we are to teach those who have been saved. Go share, baptize, and teach. That's what it says. Go share, baptize, teach. And I've often explained that the Holy Spirit gives different gifts to different believers. And one of those gifts is the God-given gift of evangelism. You know, the ability and the desire to share Jesus with people in such a way that many people get saved. Billy Graham jumps to mind. I went to listen to Billy Graham in Bristol many years ago. We were at Ashton Gate, and the football ground was absolutely full. And Billy Graham got up and he preached a message. Well, as one preacher to another, I didn't think much of the message, to be honest. And yet when he said, "I want you to get up out of your seats," the power of God fell, and thousands got up out of their seats and came forward and gave their hearts to the Lord. That's the gift of evangelism. That's what changes a simple message into something wonderful. But I got some news for you. There was a study done which showed that only 10% of all believers have got the gift of evangelism, which means that those who've got it had better make sure that they're using it. 10%. Now, don't sigh in relief because you feel it's not your gift, because the other 90% have still got a responsibility to support the spreading of the gospel, even if they don't have the gift of evangelism. All of us have got to share that responsibility the responsibility of the church by praying for it to grow and have the increase. Amen?
Amen.
We need to be going around and inviting the unchurched to come to church. And one of the things we've got to do is to warmly welcome those who do come. We don't need to be stumbling blocks. We all have to serve the ministry of the church. Now, if you don't have the gift of evangelism, I'll tell you this. You have got other talents, and you've got other abilities that you should be using. We should be using our God-given talent to serve, even if the hole is not at your end of the boat. Let me tell you a story. A man who had regularly prayed for many years began to wonder if God heard his prayers at all. And during one of his routine times of prayer, this doubting pattern increased. So he stopped praying, and he thought for a moment, and he said, "Oh, enough of this." He lifted his eyes up towards heaven and yelled, "Hey up there, can you hear me?" And there was no response. So he kept on, "Hey God, if you can really hear me, tell you what you want me to do with my life." And all of a sudden, a voice from above thundered in reply, "I want you to help the needy and give your life for the cause of peace." Now, faced with more of a challenge than the man really wanted, this is what he answered. "Well, actually, God, I was just checking to see if you were there." And the voice from above then answered, with disappointment in it, "That's all right. I was only checking to see if you were there." Why is it that we have a hard time with service? Why is it that we humans have a hard time serving other people? There's a rule. If you take in and you don't give out, you become fat. If you give out and you don't take in, you become faint. If you give out and take in, you become fit. Someone put it this way. Impression without expression leads to depression. Can I say that one again to you? Impression without expression leads to depression. If we are just taking in and taking in and taking in, and we're never giving out, what good is it? You see, going to church and learning about God, Jesus, and the Bible is a good thing. But if we don't do anything with it, it's useless. We just become a walking book of theology. In Ephesus, there were a lot of people who just loved to sit and read, study, and debate the Bible. So Paul wrote a letter to the young pastor, Timothy, and told him, that's not the purpose of a church. Paul told Timothy that the purpose of learning the Bible is not just that you know more about the Bible. Paul told Timothy that the purpose of learning the Bible was not so that you could win a debate or persuade someone to come to your side. Paul told Timothy that just studying the Bible just leads to endless discussions and debates, which really doesn't do anyone any good. Paul also told Timothy that these people needed to change their purpose in studying the Bible. And he said to Timothy that they just needed to stop reading and debating the Bible. And if you read 1 Timothy 1 verse 5, it says, "The goal of this command is love, which comes from a pure heart, a good conscience, and a sincere faith." Church, the goal of studying the Bible is that we learn to love God and others. Amen? And you know in 1 Corinthians 13, it tells us that love is not just words of feeling. It's got to be action. It's got to be service. It's got to be seen in humility. It's got to be seen in submission. That's the purpose of studying the Bible. We study the Bible in order to learn how to love God more and how we can love our fellow man more. Let me repeat it to you. Impression without expression leads to depression. And of course, the expression of love is the service that God is looking for. But we do seem to make a load of excuses for not serving others. We don't want to serve if the hole is not at our end of the boat. We don't want to serve if we don't know enough about the Bible. We don't want to serve if people don't appreciate what we're doing. We don't want to serve if we don't think we've got any talent. We've all got excuses why we don't want to serve. But if anyone ever had a reason for not serving, it was Jesus. If anyone ever deserved not to serve, but to be served, it was the creator of the world.
Amen.
And if ever anyone ever deserved to be served, it was the savior of the world. But listen to what he said. Let me read it to you again. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve.
Yeah.
And to give his life as a ransom for many. Jesus came to be a servant. He came to set an example for you and I to follow. In other words, to serve. Therefore, when I come into membership into a church, I'll serve the church. And I'll serve the church by taking the following steps. Firstly, I'll make every effort to discover what my gifts and my talents are. 1 Peter 4. Each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. Now, many people think that since they can't preach, and they can't teach, and they can't lead singing, there's nothing for them to do. But the truth is, all of us have got talent that we can use. And the Bible calls talent gifts. All of us have at least one of these gifts that have been given to us by God to use in the service to others. The passage doesn't say, if you have a gift, you should use it. It assumes that everyone has a gift. Let me read it to you. Each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. Now, we can't call God a liar by saying that we haven't got any gifts. So the first step that you and I should take is to discover the gift that the Holy Spirit has given to us personally. So the question to you this morning, what's your spiritual gift? Because 1 Corinthians 12, verse 7 says, now to each one the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. That passage makes it very clear that each one of us has been given at least one gift by the Holy Spirit. And it also makes it clear that the purpose is for the common good. That means for the good of others. You see, these gifts are not to be used to build ourselves up or to exalt ourselves. They're given to build up the church. They're given to build up others. And the first thing that we need to do is to discover what our gifts are. And to do that, we need to understand what spiritual gifts are. They're all the way through the New Testament. I can give you the passages where you'll find them. Romans 12, 1 Corinthians 12, and Ephesians 4. They're the main places. Those three passages list at least 19 spiritual gifts. And there may even be more than that sprinkled throughout the New Testament. Now, once we know what they're called, we need to know what they're like. We need to know the description of the gifts. We need to learn what each of those gifts are and then determine which ones that the Holy Spirit has given to us. Now, by the way, I should and I can help you. Because the second step is being equipped to serve by pastors. That's the reason for a pastor. Ephesians 4. It was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, some to be pastors and teachers, to prepare God's people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. I don't really know where I stand in this, because there's three prophets we've had here have called me an apostle. I've also been called a teacher. I've also been called a pastor, so I get a bit confused on occasion, which hack the way to be. And I'm not showing off. That's where we are. But part of why God gives pastors, and they're gifted, is to bring people to a place where they use their gifting. Amen? This passage says that we, as pastors, have to prepare people, God's people, for works of service. The reason I teach the Bible is not just that you know more about the Bible, but we understand the Bible and we can bring it into being. The goal of our instruction is that we will go out and serve others. The purpose of studying the Bible, and I'm repeating myself, is to learn how we can love and serve others more. That's it in a nutshell. I said earlier that the first thing you need to do is to discover what your gift is. I can help you do that. I can teach you what the gifts are. I can help you assess what your gifts are. However, it really comes down to the individual. You need to get out of your seat and learn how to serve. There is no point having a gift if you're just going to sit in a seat. God's not going to reveal the gift if you're just sat in a seat. I've often talked to you about Jim Sepulveda. I'm going to repeat myself again now. Jim Sepulveda, I got to know him. And I listened to his testimony. Jim was the one who got saved. They were operating, and he died on the operating theatre. And they were writing out his death certificate when he sat up. God to heaven, and God more or less said, "Not your time. Go back. I've got a work for you to do." And Jim, after he recovered from being stitched up suddenly because there was blood flowing everywhere, after he recovered, he just went to the church and he quite openly said, "I went around giving out hymn books, and as the Americans would say, I took the babies out and changed the diapers, and I just worked in the church." But it was while he was doing that that God revealed the gift to him. I know what the gift. He had a look, an amazing amazing gift that the Spirit of God, where he was, used to come and fall. I've seen rows upon rows of people just go down under the Spirit because Jim spoke the word. He had the gift of faith. That's what. Not ordinary faith. He had the gift of faith. He just spoke it into being and it happened. But that was Jim. He started off. He came back and he just got up and he started doing things. He told me one day, he said, I was asked to come and share my testimony one day at the church. And he said, I got there and the church was absolutely packed out. And the minister took me up onto the platform and he said, I sat down there and he said, oh, I thought I was just going to be one to give a little word of testimony and then somebody was going to preach the word. And it turned out that he was the main speaker. And this is how it started for him. As he sat there panicking, and I mean panicking, when it was sunk into him that he was going to be the main speaker, he cried out to God and God said, see the lady in the green coat under the balcony? Call her out. And he did, and God healed her like that. And that's where his ministry started. But it wouldn't have started if he hadn't got up out of his seat and started to do something. If you're going to just sit in your seat, what's the point? What's the point? Are you people, Lord, I want more? What for? You're not using what you've got. Why should God give you any more if you're not using what you've got? Why do you need any more in your bucket when you're not using what's already in the bucket? Jeremy Bentham was the founder of London's University College. And when he died in 1832, according to his instructions, his skeleton was reconstructed and given a wax head, dressed in his best suit, and put in a glass case in the meeting room of the College Board of Governors. This is a true story. And for many years, the deceased Bentham attended every meeting of the board and was already described in the minutes as present but not voting. Sometimes, church, we're present and we're not serving, we're just present. Oh, bless, Peter Barnes is watching me from Norway. He comments, an apostle covers all the gifts. Hallelujah. Bless him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Peter. Nothing like being put under pressure. The book of James describes present but not serving as dead faith. You see, God brought you here because this church needs the talent that he's given to you. Amen. Young lady got saved Friday? God will be implanting gifts into her to serve others. God wants all believers to use what they've got. Can I repeat what I started with? Even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to be served. Did I say that right?
No. I didn't.
I'm testing to see if you're listening. The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. And in Ephesians 4, it gives a wonderful picture of what the church will look like when we're all using our God-given talents. Let me read it to you. Ephesians 4, and those taking notes, verses 14 to 16. Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves, and blown here and there by every wind of teaching, and by the cunning and the craftiness of men in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up into him who is the head, that is Christ. From him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love as each part does its work. So if you're not doing your work, the whole body is being affected, not just you. We are to work together as a body of believers to advance the cause of Jesus Christ. And you have got gifts that I haven't got. And I've got gifts that you haven't got. So we need each other if we're going to fulfill all of the work. But we don't become a church until we're all using our gifts. We're functioning together. We're all part of the same body. And we're working for the common good. Therefore, we will serve the ministry of the church by discovering our gifts and talents. But above all, church, you and I have got to develop a servant's heart. 3 Corinthians 2. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility, consider others better than yourself. Each of you should look not only to your own interest, but also to the interest of others. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant. It applies to you and I. Jesus set the example for you and I to become servants. But being a servant is more than something you just do. You can discover your gifts, and you can be equipped with the gifts, and still not be a servant. Because you see, being a servant is all to do what happens in the heart. If your heart is not right, you will never become a servant. Our work of service should be something that spills over from the attitude of our heart. There was a businessman once, and he asked how he could know when he had a servant-like attitude. And this was the answer that he was given: by how you act when you are treated like one. That makes sense to you? You'll know whether you've got the heart of a servant when the way you act when somebody treats you as a servant. So how do you act when you are treated as a servant? Does pride rise up and get in the way? Don't tell me you haven't got pride. Because every one of us has got it. It's whether we've mastered it is the question. Have we really obtained a servant's heart? There was a student in a Bible school in the Philippines. In the Philippines. I'm getting my Bible and my geography mixed up. And he became disturbed about the condition of the men's room, since they always seemed to be neglected in the cleaning routine. Nothing was done to eliminate the filth. So he took matters into his own hands, and he went and complained to the principal of the school. And a little while later, the student noticed that the problem was being corrected. But he saw with amazement that the man with the mop and the pail in his hand was the principal himself. And later the student commented, "I thought he would call a janitor, but he cleaned the toilets himself." It was a major lesson to the man on being a servant. And of course it raises a question in his mind: why hadn't he done it previously? So, church, are we developing a servant's heart? Many Christians have got a hard time submitting to and serving others. And yet God's word, Christ's example, are absolutely consistent. Ephesians 5. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Galatians 5. You, my brothers, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the sinful nature. Rather, serve one another in love. And Mark 10. Then I say it to you again. Even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. You see, servanthood is all about you and I developing the right heart. Are we developing a servant's heart like our Master Jesus? Or are we allowing pride to get in the way? I challenge you. Jesus will do anything for you. Will you do everything for Jesus? There's the challenge, isn't it? He'll do anything and everything for you and I. But will we do everything for him? Let me conclude. Many Christians don't understand the purpose of church. They think the church is for what they can get out of it. You see, that's what your attitude is. What can I get out of it? If you come here this morning thinking, oh, what will I get out of it? Then you've got the wrong attitude. It really should be, what can I put into it?
Yeah.
Our attitude should be the same as Jesus. Our attitude should be to see how much we can give. Our attitude should not be see, oh, what can I get this morning out of church? How much can I give into the body of Christ? There was a new home owner and his lawnmower broke down. It was a type that you sit on and drive. So he must have had a fair garden. And he'd been working fruitlessly for 2 hours trying to get it to start. And suddenly one of his neighbours appeared with a handful of tools. Can I help you, he said. And in 20 minutes he had the mower functioning absolutely perfect. Oh, thanks a million, the now happy newcomer said. And what a fine collection of tools you've got. What do you do with them? Any friends, he said, I'm available anytime. You see, you and I should be available anytime to cross the church to help whoever needs it, okay? Cross that church and see, like that man, turned up with his tools, so that he could help a newcomer. Simply why? Because he had a servant's heart. You and I have got to get a servant's heart. I will serve and the ministry of the church. And ministry, by the way, in this church, means if I see a need, I meet it. I don't wait for the pastor or the elder to come and tell me to do it. If I see that the toilet needs mopping, I get a mop. If I see that the chairs are out of the line, I go for a ride. Molly, tell Teddy first, yes or no? But seriously, you understand what I'm saying? If there's a need in the church, you meet it. You don't wait until pastor comes along and says, oh, I wonder if you do this. If it's there, you meet it. So church, this is what I'm saying to you. This is what I want you to say to yourself. I will serve the ministry of my church by discovering my gifts and my talents and by developing a servant's heart. What a difference this church would become. It's not What can I get out of the church? What can I give? And every one of you has got something that you can give. One of the big ones is time. I got the time, I can give it. I was blessed this week. He's not here, so I can talk about it. I came in and seen that somebody has started cleaning all down the side of the church. Nobody asked. Matt came in, got the power washing and started. What a difference it's made all the way down the side. Servant's heart, isn't it? Not being waited, or I'll wait till it wants me. That's pride. Just get on with it. You, and particularly, use the spiritual gift that God has given you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Yes, Bruce.